cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Something less than a masterpiece, that fugue. Had you heard it before?
Never.
Would you be willing to hear any more of it? There's quite a bit more where that came from.
I hope I can be excused, but I think I could do without it.
Really? I think it has great charm. Charm out of all proportion to its craft, actually.
Yeah, but to me it sounds more like a fugue by Handel, perhaps, than by Bach.
Oh, well, that's quite true. All those very self-confident triads. Supporting very insecure sequences. That is quite Handelian, you're quite right. But that's Bach, you know. In the early years, when he caught on to a phrase that he really liked, he just kept devaluating the currency, using it again and again as a sequence. He just coined it and couldn't stop. I mean, I suspect, to be honest, that fond as I am of it, and I really am, that had it not been for the fact that we see him writing a rather special subject.
B-A-C-H.
Well, yeah, German-speaking keyboards say B-A-C-H. Our local variety says B flat, A, C, B natural, which spoils the fun. But had it not been for the fact that on German-speaking keyboards you can make him write a fugue subject on his own name, I think this piece might well have languished in more obscurity than it's found already. But having said that, I still think it is a very, very charming piece, and a lot better than some of the other early fugues that he wrote, in fact.
Are you thinking of the fugues from the toccatas, for instance?
The toccatas, and some of the early organ works, too, where he gets involved in exactly the same kind of sequential hang-ups that he does here. You know, it's not... We have this happy idea that because Bach turned out, arguably, to be the greatest craftsman of all time, that he started out that way, that he produced masterpieces in his playpen, and he did not. He was not even a very fast starter as a fugue writer, you know. What he had, right from the earliest days, it seems, was the ability to write music of incredible intensity and pathos, the kind of recitatives that you get in the toccatas. Even the earliest ones could virtually have gone into the Matthew Passion, and you know, I mean, they're extraordinary things. But he did not have the ability to integrate that intensity with a real fugal craft until he was, I think, close to 40. You know.
Well, is there an example of integration that you could give us now?
How about the E major fugue from the second volume of the Multiprichavier? Most original thought, but what a choral piece this would have made.
Absolutely. Every line seems to be conceived vocally.
Yeah, yeah. And maybe because he wasn't trying to cater to an instrument in any way, there's a sense that there isn't a wasted note, there isn't an artificial, a superficial note. Everything is material to the material. Everything absolutely grows out of the original subject, you know, the original six notes which started it all. First counter theme does. Because that counter theme is just a transposition of the subject to with a little bit of ornamentation. And then after he gets through the exposition, what I just played, the exposition where every voice has its say once, he starts into the first of those wonderfully compact, convoluted, in the best sense of the word, stretto overlaps. Only in this one, the counter theme gets its own stretto as well.
So that the two ideas seem to develop in tandem.
Exactly. And in tandem or otherwise, they move, well, one can't say they modulate together. They sort of bump into the submedian key, C-sharp minor, thusly. And when he gets there, he does something rather cute. He takes the original subject and the original answer, starting on the notes, which they did start on, E and B, respectively, and transforms them, reharmonizes them, finds a way of giving them a sort of tonal visa to pass through C sharp minor.
As they're doing so, they're associated in that same key with a new counter subject, complete with its own counter subject.
Yeah, that's true. Well, I said, yes, that's true, and that's not quite true, because in a way, what this is a kind of wild permutation of the very first motive with which, in the second bar, he accompanies the answer. So, far-fetched as it may seem, even that doesn't go to waste entirely. Something very nice. He takes the theme, deprives it of the one expressive interval it has, the minor third, and fills it in as one would sing it in a scale. Then makes the alto comment on that, also sort of filling in the pattern. Except that in the alto, he starts to play around with the modes and goes up one way, dee-da-da-da, and comes back down another, dee-da-da-da. Then he adds a new counter theme in the bass, also based on the original idea of dee-dee-dee-dee, and also expanding it to the interval of a fifth, dee-da-da, and then puts that into a canon in the tenor, just in case anybody's missed the point. Then they leave F sharp minor by the same submedian root by C sharp minor exit. Then you get another one of those glorious stretto occasions, as in the second sentence of the piece. Then he does something very, very interesting. After that stretto, for the first time, he introduces six diatonic notes in a row, which doesn't seem like doing anything very special. But up to then, every motive that he's used has either been delineated by a fourth, as in, or on a fifth, as in the case of the counter subjects. He suddenly adds six notes successively. Then in canon, seven. Then, as though to sort of celebrate the ending, which seems to be close by. Except that isn't that close. He's going to back off once more, and he backs into the submedian key, which he hasn't visited before, G sharp minor. And from that, he goes to a coda which begins with the only diatonic scale in the entire piece, in scale of E major. So we have first the six-note thing, the seven-note extension, the eight-note extension, and it's rudimentary material, but it makes for one of the most gloriously fulfilled codas he ever wrote, I think.
Well, what about playing the whole fugue now?
Yeah, okay, I think I should. And one masterpiece coming up. Thank you. As I said, a masterpiece.
Yeah, for the moment at least, it's for me the my favorite in all music.
Oh, I know that feeling. I often wondered if it mightn't have been Schoenberg's, Arnold Schoenberg's favorite piece, you know. It exemplifies everything that he believed in. He had that theory that he called developing variation, where every note and every bar and every phrase and every sentence and every paragraph had to be seen to belong to that organism and to no other. And I can't think of any piece that exemplifies that in the way that this does. Yeah?
I agree, but don't you think that that E major fugue is a very special case?
Hmm?
It is a vocal composition. I mean, like a vocal composition,
oh,
as
certainly.
You said.
It's a 16th century Richard Carle with a key signature. It has that very disciplined, very severe, very very Renaissance-like attitude toward counterpoint. You know?
Yeah, but there are many great fugues which don't subscribe to those particular disciplines so rigidly, which do grow out of an instrumental approach.
Oh, sure.
That doesn't make them less worthy as compositions.
Oh, no, of course not. Well, for example, the first three-part invention, the first sinfonia, you know. Well, that's based on a subject that you would not be likely to sing. I guess you could. Well, not, no, you couldn't. Not very easily. And it could only be an instrumental approach, but I certainly wouldn't say it's any the less worthy for that reason. Little symphony is every bit as concentrated as the E major fugue.
It certainly is.
Yeah. Of course, the fugue really was a combination of Renaissance ideas about imitation and voice leading and so on, the kind of ideas that were in that E major fugue, and of Baroque ideas of key order and key relationship about the uses of the diatonic scale and the pecking order of its chords and so on.
Well, the kind of harmonic patterns that made that symphony hold together.
Yeah, exactly. All of the imitative devices that we know in fugue, canon and inversion and augmentation and diminution, all that sort of thing. All of the mathematical processes were in place in the Renaissance, you know, and all were used with great sophistication in the 16th century, really. But the fugue, in order to be independent, in order to stand on its own feet, needed something else. And I think that something else was tonality. It really is a celebration of the tonal system, of the peculiar stresses and strains and pulls and pushes and magnetic attractions of one chord for another.
Yeah, but you're not saying that the fugue, for instance, in Bach's time, depends upon tonality as in the way that the sonata Allegro does in Beethoven's time.
No, because the pecking order there is really quite different. I think, however, that there is nothing in the nature of fugue that would want to demand what Beethoven would demand of the relationship between a tonic and a dominant, or a tonic and a mediant for his first and second themes. Bach would have no use for that particular kind of tonic, mediant, tonic, dominant relationship, you know. But that's a plus, that's a great plus, in a way, because the fugue then is not locked into a have-to concept. There is no specific modulatory plan that to which it has to conform. The composer can use as much or as little modulation as he wants, and he can present a whole series of, as Schoenberg would have said, developing variations of the material in different keys. You
know, well, that Bach did in the E major fugue.
Yeah, but there was a kind of, well, I say a kind of gradual, inevitable Darwinian evolution of the material, which is very, very marvelous in its existential way. But it isn't, in quotation marks, modern in Bach's time. And there is a marvelous example of a modern fugue in the B flat minor, you know, from Book Two. You know, that piece is of a totally different order than the E major. The theme appears as we sung it, more or less. And then at the end of the exposition, in canon for the first time. So on. Then later on in inversion. and so on. And every time he changes the process, every time he looks at it from a different angle, he positions it in a different key to show that angle, even though the first statements of those processes may very well be the tonic. For example, at the end of the exposition, as a kind of wrap-up to the exposition, he does put it into the canon for the first time. Modulates very subtly, modulates to the mediant and produces this absolutely enchanted version in canon. You know, and he's not using tonality, though, even by doing that, by relating the tonic and the mediant. He's not using tonality as even many of his contemporaries, Scarlatti, say, used it. To use a fashionable word, Bach was not a minimalist, you know. He wasn't concerned about staying put in one key, but the dramatic effects of doing that. He wasn't concerned about trying to balance so many minutes of key X with so many minutes of key Y for the second theme or whatever. He's really not terribly concerned ever about exploiting the whole process of time itself as a compositional element in the way that later composers, the classical composers particularly, were. I mean, when Bach juxtaposes a tonic and a mediant, as he did there, it's a totally different kind of juxtaposition of keys than this tonic. Juxtaposed with this mediant. You know, Bach, unlike Beethoven, uses all those keys as you might use stops on an organ. They give them ideas, they give them colors, they give them registrations for the incredible, incredible motivic workings out that are taking place in this rather incredible fugue. Thank you. You know, one almost has to coin some other word than modulation for what Bach does in a fugue like that. It's not modulation just. It's key perception or something like that. He perceives the qualities inherent in every key he passes through in a spooky way. It's marvelous.
Yeah, absolutely. It's not just an amazing contrapuntal to the force. No. It's also an amazing harmonic conception.
Harmonic, absolutely. Yeah, indeed.
You know, Glenn, I can't help noticing that in all our discussion, you've not once mentioned the word prelude.
The word prelude, you say? Well, no, it's a splendid word. How many times would you like me to mention it?
Well, if you're talking about the well-tempered clavier, what about just as many times as the word fugue?
Well, I tell you, I personally think that a lot of the fugues in the well-tempered clavier are better off without their attending preludes and vice versa.
Oh, come on, that really is
well, there's no accounting for taste, Bruno. I do, though. I think that there are great preludes. There are fantastic pieces. I didn't mean that to sound patronizing. They're incredible preludes, marvelous preludes. But they very often, especially the good ones, the really good ones are the ones that bother me the most, because very often they don't match their fugues. And I can't give you any better example of that than the prelude that prefaces that incredible E major thing that we talked about before, in front of a magnificent neo-Renaissance edifice. What does he put? He puts a gentle, lovely, charming, rococo, bewigged 18th century trio sonata. It makes no sense. It's a wonderful piece, but I can't see for the life of me what it's got to do with that incredible fugue. It's as if the two movements are 100 years apart, technically, and emotionally as if they just belong to a different world altogether, a different way of looking at the world altogether.
Yeah, but are there no preludes and fugues that, in your view, do add up to something more than the sum of their parts?
Well, I don't know about more than the sum of their parts. I think there are some that seem to have sprung spontaneously from the same creative impulse, a few, yeah.
I think you owe us at least one of those.
At least one. Well, I think I would vote for the A major from book two of the well-tempered clavier. I think that one really is all of the piece, all of a very gentle, lyrical, quietly optimistic, utterly charming piece. Thank you. that prelude and that fugue belong together.
Yes, they absolutely do. Glenn, what is it that gave the fugue such a major role in Bach's creative life? And what is it with that matter that keeps it going, or kept it going, to the point that one gets polytonal fugues, atonal fugues, 12-tone fugues, and even fugues at the end of symphonies for most romantic composers?
Sure. Great choruses.
I mean, what is it that accounts for that continuing fascination for the fugue?
Well, I suppose there are many reasons, really. I think perhaps there is one that is predominant and that is really very difficult to define. I think it has something to do with a very special need that certain types of artists exhibit, need to prove that what they do is valid, that it's not achieved by random selection, that every moment flows logically from the moment before to the moment after. It's not confined to musicians, that need, but maybe because music itself is so unprovable, so improbable, you know, one might almost say, musicians somehow seem to exhibit it more prominently than some other types of artists. It's very difficult at times, with certain kinds of music particularly, to say why something strikes one as appropriate or inappropriate. You know, you and I have often argued about middle period Beethoven, and I do not intend to reopen that argument again.
But I'm certainly glad to hear that.
No, I wouldn't dream of that. I've given that up as a lost cause. I don't really ever expect to persuade you of the pomposity of the Fifth Symphony, or the banality of the Violin Concerto, or the empty rhetoric of the Appassionata Sonata. No, I would not think of reopening that argument, as I say. And in fact, when you come right down to it, there is no way to argue it, as I think we found from frustrating past experience. I mean, I can say to you, this is a tiresome idea.
I would say to you right away, I mean, in the context, this is a marvelous idea.
In the context, you see, you would have to say that. I'm sure you would. But notwithstanding our argument, Beethoven, as we all know, had a very special temperament. Because in those middle years, when he wrote that junk, he had absolute confidence that what he did was valid, just because he did it. You know, it's a great gift. I'm not arguing against intuitional creativity or anything like that there. I'm simply saying that most composers don't have that gift. They don't have that audacity. They don't have the nerve to try and get away with something as silly as that, really. They can't talk themselves into it, much less expect that the listener is going to accept what they do as by a leap of faith or something, you know. Most composers are just much more fragile than was Beethoven. I mean, why do you think Richard Strauss wrote all those incredible tone poems of his in which every thematic idea, every modulation had to be accounted for by a literary parallel of some kind? I think he did it. I think he erected all those programmatic scaffolds to convince himself, really, that everything he did had an architectural reason, that there was nothing that was improvisatory in terms of the structure, that everything belonged. And he did it so well, as you can take down those scaffoldings, you can play Until Eulenspiegel for a child who's never even heard the term program music and get a very positive and purely musical reaction, you know, which is the way it should be. Well, I think in a funny way, contrapuntal forms, fugues and canons and so on, are like that. You know, either a canon works or it does not work. Either it fulfills the particular thou shalt and thou shalt not of the canon form, or it doesn't do that. And in the same way, the fugue is a process which is about process, really. It concentrates on process. And one is not likely in a fugue to be seduced by the momentary attraction or distraction of a particular idea. I mean, you can say to me, I think that the ninth fugue, the Art of Fugue, is a rather intrusive and virtuosic subject. And if you did say that, I really wouldn't disagree with you, to tell you the truth. But I would say to you, well, no matter, it works. It works as a subject in its own exposition, and it works as a counter theme. It mates perfectly well with the main theme of the Art of Fugue. So, in a way that we will never be able to find agreement about the second theme of Beethoven's Emperor Concerto, we could say, well, okay, it's a theme of no distinction whatsoever, but it does have an ongoing relationship with the totality of this particular structure, with the totality of the Art of Fugue, you know?
Well, you're mentioning the Art of Fugue, of which you're going to play three fugues in a moment.
Yes, the second, the fourth, and the 15th.
Do you share the general view that this is the culmination of all Bach's fugue writing?
Yes, I do, but not specifically because of its scope and scale and technical wizardry and all that sort of thing. Not just because one theme generates 15 fugues and 4 canons, amazing as that is. There are moments in the art of fugue that are much more valuable than its virtuosity, I think. Moments that, for me, absolutely surpass everything else that Bach wrote. I really can't think of any music that moved me more deeply than that last fugue, you know?
The unfinished
one. The unfinished fugue, and not just because of all the emotional associations that we inevitably bring to it, not just because we know that he died, leaving it incomplete, leaving it literally in the middle of a bar, already enormously long as it was. It really is because that final fugue has a sense of peace, a devotional quality that I think even for Bach is really overwhelming. The interesting thing about that final fugue, and to some extent about all of the art of fugue, is that in it he literally turns his back on every tendency abroad in the musical world of his time.
Well, by the time he wrote it, fugues were very unpopular.
Oh, well, hugely unpopular, and fugal adventures of this size and tenacity were simply unheard of. They had no place at all in the 18th century scheme of things. Fugues were out and minuets were in, I guess. But more than that, Bach actually, I think, quite deliberately changes his harmonic style in this work. There is nothing in the art of fugue remotely like the clear-cut modulations of that B-flat minor fugue, for example, or the E major fugue that we talked about a few moments ago, or almost any of the earlier fugues, really. Instead, he reaches back at least 100 years and borrows a type of counterpoint and a concept of key association from the North German and the Flemish composers of the early Baroque, this kind of texture. Allows him to write tonally, but without any of the technicolor trappings of tonality. For me, these pieces contain an endless range of gray tints. I mean, as a compliment, because I love gray. Schweitzer, as a matter of fact, had some marvelous things to say. He said it was a still and serious world, deserted and rigid, and without color, and without light, and without motion, and so on. He was talking about the first fugue, I think, specifically, but that pretty well sums up my feeling about the last one, too, I must say. But the other side of the coin is that Bach introduces into the art of fugue a degree of chromaticism that in many respects reaches out, I think, at least until the time of Wagner, at least for 100 years beyond his own time. There's nothing remotely like it in between, really. And it's very similar to Wagnerian and post-Wagnerian chromaticism in that it constantly reaches farther and farther and farther. It never modulates in the conventional sense. It never comes to rest in any one key, you know, but it leaves this extraordinary impression of an infinitely expanding universe. Moments like this, which could almost have been written by early Schoenberg, you know.
But of course, in this last fugue, he also develops three separate subjects, the last of which is the one on his own name.
That's right, and there could not be a more striking, more amazing contrast between the way he uses those four notes here and the way he used them at the beginning of the fugue that I played at the top of the program. I mean, here, all of the extroversion, all of the superfluous excitement is gone, you know. He's literally signing his name to what he obviously knew would be the work that summed up his life. And since that life was one in which he moved farther and farther outside of the orbit of expectations that the world thrust upon him, in all of his work, even in those moments of great vigor and great energy and so on, he manages to telescope that incredible journey in really the most extraordinary way.